Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome back. So we are about to start the second session, Political Objects, New Values Indexes. I'm going to moderate the session. I'm Marina Otero. And well, you have been, I didn't follow the first session because I just arrived, so I hope that we didn't go back again to the same questions, but bring new ones. So in case we fall into the same ideas, please raise your hand and stop it. So we are going to talk about indexes, and indexes are generally used to the measuring cities. The measurement of cities' performance has been mobilized as one of the ways in which we can assess the success of strategies, policies, legislations that drive the transformation of cities. These studies are generally produced by multi-governmental institutions, by business consultancies, by research foundations, and media outlets. Their indexes provide resources for governments, for business leaders, for investors to learn about cities' strengths and weaknesses, are used for tracking trends, are used for understanding investment patterns, effects of policies to evaluate possibilities and risks. They are expected to shed light into the ingredients that make a city successful, something that in that context generally translates into the capacity to attract or build investments and new urban developments. And in the last decades, we have seen there is a proliferation on indexes, most of the times created as part of marketing and communication campaigns, which somehow acknowledge the fact that indexes are a product of design, and first are designed, and therefore, and later are validated. So with that in mind, we are asking different practitioners, designers, to think about what type of indicators, changes, performances, and specific observations we think are relevant to examine, measure, value, and rank. What do we want to predict and to represent about cities? Should an index be accurate or consistent over time? And what are their relevance for decision makers, but also for communities? To reflect on these questions, we have seven panelists who will do six presentations about the new indexes that might provide new indicators about the value of cities. And I'm going to start calling one by one. So we will going to start with Ingrid Barrington. So I think, Ingrid, your name will show up soon as the moving image stops, but maybe you can come to the stage. Here you go.
Hello, thank you so much for having me. Often when I'm trying to figure out a new talk, I'll put ideas on index cards. And since this talk was about making an index, I figured in lieu of slides, I would literally just show you some index cards. So my name's Ingrid. I am an artist and writer. And I'm not going to be showing a lot of my own work today because I went with this index card gimmick. Conveniently, some of my work actually briefly appeared in David's presentation. I designed one of the Center for Urban Pedagogy books he included. It was kind of nice to see that, and I thought about that project in a while. I also did a project that I guess I'd been working on between 2014 and last year, which was a field guide to network infrastructure on the street, basically ways of identifying indicators of like network systems that would be a kind of accessible in a much more kind of like quotidian sense than the kind of charismatic mega infra that tends to get represented as being what seeing the internet looks like. So that's kind of the difference between like looking at a data center and looking at like a fiber optic cable, which just sort of seemed relevant for explaining the new index that I was thinking might be interesting to present, which is not particularly new insofar as it's something that's generally kind of around or is kind of about history in a sense, but that is maybe one that smart cities are not always attuned to. And so I was thinking about seams and making a seam index. So this seems like a very smart room, so maybe I don't need to explain all of these things to you, but cities are full of seams, right? That's sort of what makes them interesting. They're the way, you know, there's all these little things that have to happen to make different kind of everyday things work, right? And there's lots of different categories of ways of thinking about the seams of cities, the little sort of interstitials and necessary activities. So those could be spaces of visible repair or maintenance, stuff that kind of reminds you that, like, this stuff doesn't just work, right? A city is not something that kind of just continues to operate and requires no degree of, like, human intervention. I think about, like, street excavation or seeing, like, cable laying. Whenever I see people working in an open manhole, I, like, kind of go out of my way to thank them because nobody does this. I have learned from doing it enough times to people who are doing that work. And they're often, especially if they're doing stuff like cable laying, like stuff related to fiber, it's like nobody really tells them, like, thank you for your service, for making the internet a thing. But I highly encourage you to do that. Seams as kind of a metric are also sort of a way of thinking about, like, kind of the sediment of cities, all of this, because infrastructure, as many people here probably are familiar with, tends to be built on top of whatever was used before, and they're sort of a reminder of all of the kind of layers of stuff that goes into building a place and making a place kind of continue to run, and sort of reminders that, like, this is not kind of like all grand new stuff that was created in one, like, fell modernist swoop, although, as the previous panel indicated, sometimes I guess it is. Examples of that might include things like pavement, you know, patchworks that kind of remind you of newly buried conduits that have been paved over, or things like spray-painted utility markings. That's a little drawing of what one might look like. Or things like, you know, that sort of, like, post-graffiti minimalism of, like, sort of new canvases that are put on the street when you use, like, the wrong kind of color of beige to paint over a beige wall where graffiti used to be, where you've actually kind of just created a new place with a frame for a nice new piece of graffiti. I often, like, think about how fun it would be to get, like, a big industrial, like, sander and sort of just look at every different layer of those pieces. And so the metric of kind of like how many of these different squares and how many times has this wall been painted over, I think, is kind of a nice metric. And seams also can be these sort of spaces for surprise or changing the way that you kind of engage with the city that can be used maybe in unexpected ways. I think of things like scaffolding or rarely, I mean, increasingly street furniture is kind of designed against the idea of improvisation, but I think of things like the artist Caroline Woolard's project from, I think, like 2010, where she turned an NYPD barricade into a bed. And I often think about how, like, maybe in, you know, the not too distant future, we're going to need to turn those into stretchers during the insurrection. So I was really inspired by that image. Similarly, scaffolding is something that on a rainy day sort of ceases to be merely an indicator of repair, but is also a kind of unexpected blessing on a rainy day, or it's a unexpected temporary bench on a sunnier day, or I don't know if anyone else has experienced this in a protest, like standing on top of a scaffold is a really good way to figure out what the hell is going on. Commemorative plaques, I wasn't really sure where to fit these, but I think taking a very liberal interpretation of what a commemorative plaque is, varying from things that kind of remind you of, again, like the history of the place that is there before you, and also sort of the historiography of, like, how did this plaque end up here? Because that's sort of the question I always ask when I see one. But then also, I spent a fair amount of time in the Southwest this summer, or not this summer, actually, just very recently. It was just felt like summer there. But fallout shelter signage, which you see in New York City, but when you're in, like, New Mexico, just outside of White Sands Missile Range, all the fallout shelter signs sort of start to mean something else in the urban environment. And so I think this is probably a room that doesn't need to be sold too hard on sort of the poetic quality of a seam, right? We had a talk that already, like, name-dropped Peric. I'm sure I don't need to reread, like, Meryl Lederman Ukulese's manifesto to this audience. But I think there is a certain kind of political urgency to thinking about the seams and kind of, like, visible kind of, like, acts of, like, maintenance and repair that go into keeping a city functioning in the face of a certain kind of smart city rhetoric. This is a quote from an essay by an artist, Julian Oliver, who is someone I admire and respect a lot. And in this context, he was talking about cellular infrastructure, about the ways in which our inability to comprehend the complexity of network systems means that it's very hard for us to understand kind of the political frames in which we're acting, which is to say the ways in which our communications can be intercepted or surveilled. But I think that there's like a larger point to this about the ways in which we understand kind of like our, you know, ourselves as political actors in a city, in a space, to be kind of period. And I think that there was a part of this, there was a logical leap to talking about grime, which I'm not sure where it went. But I think it had to do with the idea of basically like needing to see the ways in which like there's sort of a humanity to these systems. Maybe to that earlier point, you know, the previous talk in the last session about atmosphere and dust, the realities of you know, human beings run smart cities. Smart cities actually can't keep running by themselves autonomously, no matter how much humans want to insist that they do. And I don't know, I have a lot, I'm often quite uncomfortable with the visions of smart cities as kind of these sort of like beautiful, as previously discussed in the last talk, like places that don't actually seem to have any people. I think of it as kind of this ongoing war on grime being waged in architectural renders and in cities that seem to be insisting on becoming an architectural render of themselves. Like if anyone's ever like walked along the Embarcadero in San Francisco, you might know what I'm talking about. There's like no litter. It's really upsetting. And so maybe this is a metric for thinking about what networked objects or what smart devices within a city could do or look like as a way of thinking about their usefulness or their kind of value add to an environment, is also thinking about how they relate back to the humanity that they're, you know, kind of engaged with and part of, right? I think of, like, when designing your, Wi-Fi kiosk that's going to be on every intersection, think, like, what is this going to look like when it gets rusty? What's this going to look like when it's got, you know, dirt on it? What's going to look like when a bird shits on it? Like the sense of like this thing needs to actually kind of be normal when it's dirty, not something that like belongs in a mall. And so I don't know, I support the idea of thinking of this as an index that's useful for thinking about designing for grimes and with a recognition of the seams that are part of making a city function. Thanks.
Hello, I'm Farzan.
I'm Mark.
We're going to do something naughty. We're going to be two people instead of one. I'd like to thank Ava and Max and Storefront for all of the work and effort and for inviting us, and for Shannon from the New School. And also thank you to Marina for moderating this panel, but also Marina and Gus from the Het Noy Institute originally commissioned the project that we're going to present today. And so maybe to kind of, you know, in a conference on smart cities, and as the second sort of presenters on the second panel, probably a lot of the great arguments have already been said in some way, and so we apologize for saying some of the same things in slightly different ways, but we'll try to say it through this specific project that we're going to talk about, and to just rehash some of the kind of, you know, global epidemic that's the smart city movement. During the past decade, the smart city has gone from concept to global movement. It's attached to a staggering number of projects and incentives and technologies and public relations campaigns. This is our lecture, the Urban Index. And so the term connotes a forward-thinking urban planning attuned to the comforts of residents and the demands of global capital. From the construction of newly built smart cities to the smartening up of existing cities, the global smart city market, an agglomeration of governance projects and technology products, is expanding, and its value is estimated to reach over 1.5 trillion by 2020. And what's kind of happening is that many technology companies are realigning their strategic interests from the production of software for users to the production of cities for citizens. And so we're both architects, and we're kind of coming at this and looking at what this means for the city and what this really means at multiple scales down to the scale of the body. And so these are the sort of images of the smart city that we know, right? And we've seen all different versions of it, and we're literally interested in what this image of the city means and looks like, literally what the smart city and how it produces images of the city, but also what we mean by the type of image it connotes for a type of urbanism and how it anticipates, manages, and in a sense starts to produce it. And so this is what we know about the smart city, right? Like outside of those shiny renderings that we've all seen, it's somehow this smooth kind of analytical diagrams where everything comes together and literally, you know, the cloud infrastructure falls down and the app gets to the citizen and you start to sort of interact with your city in some way. And so for us, what's interesting is that there has been this shift where citizens now occupy two distinct roles. And I think one of those roles we understand that insidious role perhaps where the citizen is becoming a mobile sentient sort of data recorder, or what has been termed citizen sensors. But we're also interested in what happens when the citizen becomes the end user of the smart city and what that really means when we start to think of the citizen as an end user. And so our contribution to this conference is literally, is this, where is it? is this image here. And that image here is part of this exhibition here. I've got lots of things to juggle up here. And so it's literally this image, and this image is from the exhibition, but we're also, as I mentioned, literally interested in the image of the smart city. And so this project, Control Syntax Rio, that's on right now, Storefront for Art and Architecture, originally commissioned by the Hetnor Institute, really starts to think about how examines and responds to the Center for Operations in Rio, so commonly known as CORE, an IBM Smart Cities initiative that was conceived and constructed over 4 months in 2010 as a command and control center. And so this was built to assist the city of Rio in the daily management of the traffic infrastructure. CORE now monitors its urban camera network and information sensors, gauges optimal traffic patterns, determines landslide risk zone, predicts weather disruptions, and maps disease paths. CORE also holds a special place as one of the most visible sites of smart city experimentation. And so, as opposed to the seams that Ingrid was just talking about, I think through CORE we can really examine this encounter between the global fantasies of smoothness, right, of rationality, meeting and kind of clashing with the specific physical and economic life of the city of Rio. And so the exhibition shows the city of Rio structured through CORE's control syntax and smart city command processes. And there's a street route that doubles as a sort of a route literally through Rio, but also as a decision park through CORE's decision-making matrix.
Sorry, we're going to have to do this. And so because we were asked to think about the index, it's been a bit of a challenge for us. In that that is not the terms of our project, but helpful in a sense, because the index seems to be a relatively clear idea. We think we know what that means when we say it, and yet it's also fairly elusive, in that index can mean the computational sense of a multi-dimensional array of data, or index in the economic sense of indicator that Marina pointed out, or in the semiotic sense as a particular type of sign. So the index touches, at the very least, questions of administration, information, and signification, all territories that are implicated in CORE and smart city operations. And so this compelled us to consider different types of indices for CORE, inscriptional index, an interruption index, and an urban index. So the first index, this thing we're calling the inscriptional index, is a way to think about the index through CORE as the array-like structure of the city that emerges from its sensing operations and decision algorithms. By this we mean that the conventions of urban formal organization, or zoning, or city aesthetics, with the implications of hierarchies of visual, spatial, perceptual, symbolic order, shift toward a new urban vocabulary comprised of traffic lights, motion sensors, cameras, topography, microclimates, and city geology. These are all written into or inscribed by the CORE control algorithms, producing an undifferentiated or non-hierarchical array of urban objects and actors.
The interruption index. So the primary function of these objects and actors for CORE is to register the metabolism of the city and to assess interruptions to that metabolism. Our project extracts 8 moments that can be read as entries into this interruption. So this is a map of Rio, and it shows the literal sort of 15-kilometer route through Rio that the exhibition maps a cartography of. But this 15-kilometer journey is also a path through CORE's decision-making matrix and starts to, our project extracts 8 moments that can be read as entries into an interruption index in which the normal state of the city is read against 4 levels of interruption. And so CORE's basic main task is to smoothly manage the flow of traffic and to predict, anticipate, and respond to anything that interrupts that. And that any sort of interruptions are graded on a severity from incident to event to emergency and finally to crisis. And so these are our 8 interruption indexes that we'd like to contribute to the conversation today. Chemical spill, flash flooding, military action, landslide, festival, protest, bus fire, exploding building. And in the exhibition, we sample and describe these eight moments. And through the exhibition, those eight moments and this kind of double path that's taken through Rio and through Core are represented in this type of map. And you can see where the interruptions and the incidences are presented as perpendicular to the smooth flow of traffic. And just to start to step through those and maybe talk about some of the types of incidents and interruptions that we're interested in, we have the chemical spill. And we can see this, how it's playing out both for us through our research into Core and into Rio. We started to identify these interruptions and to articulate them and to define them in some way and to draw a cartography of them. We have the sort of flash flooding that occurs due to Rio's kind of like massive sort of topographic variations and extreme weather. We have a military action happening down at the Museum of Modern Art. We have landslides that happen more often than not, and Core has a kind of a highly sophisticated weather and geological sort of prediction system that is looking and monitoring for areas that are susceptible to landslides. We have public events like a festival at the Sambadrome that also start to interrupt traffic flow from time to time. And we, of course, have, you know, mass civic forms of protest down at Avenue Presidente. I need your help with this, Marina. Vargas. And we also have buses on fire that happen more often than not due either to failing sort of civic infrastructures or forms of political protest. And exploding buildings that start to occur due to Rio's aging kind of infrastructure and gas blasts. And so I guess for us as architects and looking at this material, we would say up till now, as has been kind of said in some of the previous panels, the urban research into smart cities has seen them primarily as infrastructural networks. But what does it look like when these infrastructural networks produce subjectivities, the spaces where we participate in public life, you know, places where we take our leisure, stroll, talk, and potentially fight? And what aesthetic does that produce, and what does that aesthetic mean? And what does it mean when we start to push all of these moments through a massive sort of surveillance network infrastructure and start to produce these images of daily life in a way that perhaps sensationalizes banal acts and kind of makes sensational acts slightly more banal? And not to kind of expand this thought too much, but you know, if the smart technologies lattice the globe, what does it mean for thinking about architecture at the scale of the planet?
So just a couple more thoughts, trying to relate our project to the prompt of the index. So to help us think through some of the implications of the Smart City Index, we turn to art historian Rosalind Krauss's well-known essay Notes on the Index. Here she's trying to consider the condition of site-specific art from the 1970s and its correlation with photography. So not at all the same territory as what we are dealing with when looking at smart cities and their operations. However, one line struck us in her essay is useful and important. In talking about how photographs work indexically, Krauss argues, "The connective tissue binding the objects contained in the photograph is that of the world itself, rather than that of a cultural system." And she continues, "In the photograph's distance from what could be called syntax, one finds the mute presence of an uncoded event." So clearly, because our project is concerned with algorithms and its decision processes as a computationally determined urban syntax, it would seem to mark a sharp disagreement with Krauss's idea of the index read through photographs' indexicality. Yet because we're also concerned with the image of the city and the new system of representation that Core and smart city operations introduce, the degree to which this image is coded or uncoded is somewhat consequential. For Krauss, the photographic image and its sculptural extensions are uncoded and not syntactical because they trace directly the material of the world onto the image. This is usually what's meant by photographic indexicality. For us, the world, as conceived by Core, is a city only made legible through codes. So the image of the city is densely coded through code, as it were. And so Core and smart cities form an image of the city and initiate a new system of representation. By this, we mean not only how the city is seen through cameras, as Farzin is saying, but it is how it is seen through the sensors and data and how it represents what is happening in the city, but also how the conditions of control, optimization, decision paths become the rationality of the city and the image of that rationality. So the image appears in the sense of coordinated impressions of the city through this rationality. Yet in alignment with Krauss's reading of the index, Core is also deeply uncoded or decoupled from coding in another sense. We could say that the image of the city is one of the mute presence of a multitude of uncoded events. The image of the city then is not only a photograph or a graph or a map, but the compaction of these systems of images merged into one strata datum of representation. One result, and this is what we're interested in by how it's uncoded, is the flattening of the events by the Core algorithm and decision matrix. Protests and traffic jams appear on the same plane of meaning. The urban index is then one in which these disparate modes of action or interruption are made equivalent. So two notions of syntax collide. Syntax retains a notion of meaning insofar as relevant to instrumental operations of the city, but is decoupled from conventions of meaning in terms of political and cultural signification. This implies for Core not only the banalization of politics through the algorithm, but simultaneously the elevation or the escalation of traffic control to politics. So the rationality of smart city code and notions of the frictionless management of the city encounter the more complexly coded political, social, and topographic facts of the city. The simultaneous flattening and elevating is the myth of the smart city, and myth meant here, in Krauss's sense of unresolved contradiction, is the rational management in the face of what can't be managed, the sources of conflict, urban inequities, and structural divisions of cities into zones of affluence and zones of precarity and impoverishment. It translates precarity onto the surface of geological, climatological, or infrastructural fact, as opposed to structural forms of precarity and impoverishment. The myth points to what the algorithm can't resolve, repair, or remedy. So part of our fascination with Core is that the center aligns with images of the city as spaces of control or cybernetic feedback. It's the convergence of Cold War technologies and urban rationality. This is a space of overlap so common that it becomes one of the standard visual tropes of cinema and the Cold War. The world of defense systems, here we're looking at the NASA Control Center, and the object of megadeth calculation meeting the life of the city from Dr. Strangelove. Yet as Core illustrates, the center doesn't emerge from cinema fantasies, but from all too real alignments of urban planning policy, defense initiatives, and the conceptual construction of the post-war city as governed by images. And just to add one voice to the mix, the famous father of cybernetics, Norbert Wiener, in trying to describe what he means by this, refers to traffic jams and subways as city messaging systems. And he himself erodes the distinctions between material transportation and message transportation in the late 1940s. And Wiener is voicing a set of claims about the convergence of media, information systems, cities, and architecture that were formed and consolidated through the involvement of science, defense contractors, urban planners in America. And so the smart city is the child of that convergence. So this convergence in the post-war and in the smart city logics that appear now underscore the emergence of something we are calling in our project computational governmentality. Such computational governmentality involves citizens as sensors and participants, as Farzin has pointed out, treats them as informational units, as it interpolates them into the image of the city we have been describing. This is to say the citizens' desires and their behaviors are tracked, quantified, and in essence, indexed by Core. So through Core, we glimpse something of the urban index and the current image of computational governmentality, not only blithely directed toward engineered efficiency, but also saturated with 1,000 narratives of possible threat, risk, disruption, and instability. Thank you.
see if I can figure this out. I'm Jim Venturi. Thank you for having me. Can everyone hear me? Okay. Let's see. Anyone ever go to Angelica's kitchen here? Anyone ever miss it? It's sort of gone. How many? It's sad, right? Yeah. I mean, it's the nature of cities to change, you know? The idea that cities, architecture, it's the most fragile of the media. And cities are a reflection of our culture and our culture's values. I saw Joe Biden speak on Friday, and he said, his father used to ask, "Don't tell me your values. Show me your budget, and I'll tell you your values." And so, in a way, you could say that with cities is, show me your architecture, which is budget, and I'll show you your values. And so, you know, here's a question. I'm just going to shoot the shit here for a little bit. I apologize for that. But it's going to have some indexes. Does anyone know the building with a T on it? Yeah. Does anyone, over there, the building with the T? Yeah. So does anyone know what the T stands for or what they think it stands for? I think it stands for tuition. because after Cooper built it, they had to charge tuition. So I started to think about this question, and I started to think, well, Cooper's wonderful that it didn't charge tuition, and now they charge $20,000 tuition, and so a single building and the desire to kind of make an architectural statement led to a tuition statement, and this idea that, but is the scandal not the other way around? That what about all the other universities that are building $300 million buildings that could reduce the tuition? Rather than the idea of a binary choice of tuition versus not tuition. And perhaps architects or a new school of architecture could emerge that would be socially responsible, not just, I built social housing, therefore I'm socially responsible, but the idea that you're more creative if you can do less with the budget and therefore open up budget for other things that are perhaps more socially responsible. And so I think that's an index, in a way, is how much we spend on our architecture versus other things. And the question of, do you have to be a loss-leading chain store or a bank to be able to afford rent in the East Village? And that. And so, in a way, I'm giving a descriptive approach, and we have some analytics that I'm not so happy with in terms of giving the broad picture, but it relates to restaurants, because restaurants are civic spaces that transcend social class. In here, but I want to just think about these pictures, right? Because I came to a very different New York that I think some of the earlier presentations by Jürgen and Ingrid, which I really was very simpatico to, often made reference to the 1970s New York. I was thinking of from Taxi Driver to Taxi TV in terms of Jürgen's presentation of his XXX. Thing being associated on Taxi TV. And then Ingrid's Grime, I misread as Crime, and Crime is Necessary. And I thought, well, both are sort of true a little bit because of this issue of balance and maintaining balance in cities and such. But I don't think we can just be looking backwards as, like, let's get more crime. When I moved to New York, I think there were 2,400 murders a year in 89. And I think a lot of us would say it was a better city then. But that doesn't necessarily mean that we want our fellow New Yorkers to be murdered. So in a way, what we've done, I'm Rethink Studio is my firm. I have 12 people working with me. Some are here today, and I'm very grateful. And so we've worked on a project called Rethink NYC. And so while I'm being descriptive, we're also prescriptive in terms of where we see the problem with the planning today and how that relates to what we all deal with. How many people here, just be fairly anonymous, earn four times their rent? In other words, the typical marker for how much rent you should pay should be four times. So if you pay $2,000 a month, therefore you should earn $8,000 a month. I don't know. How many people earn that? I guess more, you earn more, no less, right? And so I think that's part of it. And a question, you know, if you think about like art in the city, imagine if you have an architecture office and you have a client that says, no, you must make it ugly like I say. And then you say, wait a minute, I don't want to make it ugly like you say. No, you must make it ugly. And then you say, okay, I resign. But if you resign, you still have to pay rent. So is there an inverse relationship between the quality of the art and the amount of the rent? You know, I think a lot of other cities are very interesting now today to artists and such. And therefore, do we have a decline in artistic, which is very hard to measure something such as artistic productivity, right? Because you can't really measure it by how much you sell the art for. In fact, that's often an inverse index. So between artistic success and money, because you know, clearly that's an example where you have to sacrifice your values for paying rent and such. So I think that's important. So anyway, so here's my perfunctory slides that talk about our attempt to get with the program here. But as pirate urban planners, we subvert and such. But I respect the program as well, so I want to deal with it in a kind of the spirit of it, if not exactly the letter. And so, you know, obviously information is power, and it can be manipulated, and we're dealing with that today, every day. And so here's this sort of metric stuff, et cetera, restaurants, yeah, okay, it's beautiful, and all that, and yeah, we got it from open data. And so this is what we really care about, which is transportation. And there's another wonderful quote by John Betjeman. This is a quote by me, actually. I don't really like it as much as John Betjeman's quote. I should just edit it. Which is, transport more than anything changes a place. Has anyone ever heard that? It's on our website. I don't think it's anywhere else. I found it from a documentary that he did. Anyone ever hear of John Betjeman? Yeah, exactly. So, okay, yeah, okay, Mary, but she did, okay. So he died in 84, pre-Thatcher-dominated Britain. Neoliberal is a big thing we're talking about, sort of versus 1970s anarchy. The balance is nice. And we don't have that now. So what Betjeman was talking about was the idea that, literally, it's just obvious on the face of it, right? Transportation changes a place. If you live in New Jersey and you can't get to New York on weekends, then it's a different place, right? So, I mean, it's a fairly clear-cut quote. So in a way, cities are really defined by their transportation systems, the way we're defined by veins as a human being, plants by region, all that's fairly straightforward. So therefore, a smart city, in a way, is a smart transportation system, because a city gives you an economy of scale, and the transportation system allows the land to be productive. You know, if you cross the river, you're looking at the swampland, you're looking at this kind of crazy thing of unused land. We really have a kind of city that's a very parochial mindset. 3 minutes left, really. What about the first site? The people were taking forever. I don't understand. So I'll try to be respectful, but I'll do my best. Anyway, the great thing about this is I'm actually just making a pitch for my May 9th event, where we're going to be giving the full presentation of this at Cooper Union. Hopefully I'm still invited. See if there's anything in the contract. So this is our vision to solve this problem of the fact that Angelica's Kitchen is now out of business. And it's basically this idea that in today's environment we're talking about, that is the definition of the core. That's the core of the city on the left. 1931, that was sort of the expansive definition of the city. In 1898, we heard it was for plumbing that we unified. But imagine the people in Brooklyn and Queens saying, you know, in 2017, you're going to be called outer boroughs. It's not one New York. You're an outer borough. And so is Staten Island, et cetera. So we're thinking more broadly about the city. We think this is at the root of all the problems, housing problems, but we don't sort of see it that way because we're not often thinking about things on the urban and regional scale because of political boundaries, cultural boundaries that tie us down. But when you think of New York almost as if it's a foreign city and use analogies such as London, Paris, Berlin, Shanghai, blah, 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 it's obvious that we're thinking in a parochial manner that's not to the level that we need to be thinking if we want to compete with those cities. And I think that's really important because that is essentially what's going on. So our plan essentially is not a transportation plan. It's the intermingling, as I sort of gave, between the social, the economic, which is the means, because you can't just raise people's taxes to pay for big things. We have to compete. We got to beat those people in Atlanta. We got to beat those people in Chicago. It's like sports, you know? And we got to have a better platform in a neoliberal way, but for the socially progressive way. So it's this hybrid idea. And again, here's more May 9th. And so basically, we're stuck with this guy. How many people have read The Power Broker? How many people started to read The Power Broker and didn't finish? How many people want to read The Power Broker? Okay, you should, because it's the most important book about New York to understand the way it is today. And there it is. And that's that. And this is the mindset that I think planners today are in, is like, you can't build anything in New York. New York's bankrupt. Let's do a subway of the Second Avenue subway and make it like the worst possible design in terms of how to get it done and say it's impossible to do it. Not because people are badly meaning, but because we don't really know what we're doing. We're figuring it out. Now, how can you not love this? How can you not prefer the kind of New York of the grime? I was at a Crames breakfast the other day, which was all real estate people, and they were saying, no one wants to go back to 1970s New York. I do. And then say, no mother would send their son to New York in 1990, or decent, well, my mother, anyway. So that's that. And so there is a beauty of this, and there's an artistic opportunity here. And so basically, these are all the projects. You hear about these in heroic terms. Gateway, we need the new Hudson River tunnels. Yes, we agree. And all the bus terminal and all this stuff, and we're all zoned out from it. But it's billions of dollars that are being spent, but basically on the premises of the Robert Moses era thinking that would have put an expressway across 13th Street, and we wouldn't be here today if that was the case. And so we need to rethink this idea that Manhattan is the core, because our projects are overstimulating the core. The overstimulation of the core equals high rent in the core. It also means that if you live in Brooklyn and Queens, the only reason way you're supposed to get to those places from other places, meaning not Manhattan, Brooklyn to Queens to New Jersey to Staten Island, is by car. And if you don't, you have to pay the price of three times longer your ride. And that's why Angelica's Kitchen is out of business, in part. She's also 67, got tired of going from 10,000 to 21,000 rent. So this is insane, and this is the solution. And this is William Wilgus's 1931 plan, 1928, something like that, for a system of transportation that mirrored the highway system that we're used to that Moses built. So the RPA, Regional Plan Association, proposed this. Moses did it, and he didn't do that. And that is what should be done, and this is what we're proposing to do, which is basically you have this insane system of transportation. Anyone who knows the suburbs knows that Long Island Railroad goes to Penn Station, but not on to Long Island, to New Jersey, and vice versa. And it's fairly boring for people that don't care. But why it matters is it's the foundation for how we can be a bigger region and colonize New Jersey. We already are, so now we can like make it less suburban and more kind of accessible. So this is our approach, which is basically just do what everyone in the world would do normally with this. And the gateway tunnels makes it possible, so we're just sort of wrong, right budget, right idea, wrong mindset, wrong design at Penn Station. And so here this continues to grow. There's the subway system added to it. Oh, let's add a subway to New Jersey. Why? Because we're going to make a hub there. It's a fun idea. And then you can put more transportation around New Jersey, because right now you have all these abandoned lines that we abandoned in the 60s mostly. And then airport that connects in. And there's a lot of stuff on our website, rethinkstudio.org. And here's a kind of different view of it. But again, same thing. Here's this today. All these right-of-ways in New Jersey exist. We can make New Jersey into part of our what could be a global city. And then eventually we have this idea of loops, hubs, and unification to turn New York into kind of what is normal. And what is normal is defined here, by the way, that's an index, as London, where the dashed lines are the commuter rail overlapping with the subway. It's a web, just like the internet, just like the water system, everything else. Imagine taking the interstate highway system and stopping in a suburb somewhere in the middle of nowhere and seeing if that works. I mean, like that, we do that with the commuter rail, you know? And here's Paris, and it has the RER, and it works well, the integration of the subways and everything. Berlin, and the other thing is the loops. You notice the loops around here. These shapes I find beautiful. And here's Tokyo. A black is commuter rail, subway. You see how it overlaps a lot? We have like Penn Station, Grand Central, and all that. So this is our pitch for the Regional Unified Network, and this is what we're doing to try to solve the problem of the fact that your rent is too high, we're killing our businesses, and we've created a sanitized neoliberal, frankly, place that we don't want to be, but at least we can close Rikers Island because of the fact that we can afford to. So that's the New York Today.
So Dawn, she actually requested to be interrogated in some way or form. So we're going to do that. And I will give you the microphone and I will exercise as the reader of those questions. Maybe you want to go here?
Can we just sit down together here, Eva? Like, let's just sit down and talk like people.
I don't know how to do that, you know? So Dawn, like the way in which we ask the questions has to do a lot with some of the things that you have put already into the public arena. So the first, and all the questions are going to come in the form of an index. So index number one, WIT, woman in tech.
Yeah.
How many women in tech are out there?
Not enough, let's just say that. There's not enough women in tech. There's not enough women in tech from a couple of different points of view. So do you mean women technologists who are actually building and coding, and there's not enough of them there? Women owning or running tech businesses, there's not enough there. And I would say really an important thing to look at, you know, what I always say when I talk about that, is that unless we change the venture capital side of the table, or you know, angel investment too, but particularly the venture capital side of the table, it's going to be hard to get women running companies and then women working in companies in tech companies in the future. So I think we have to do a better job at that. You know, and many venture capital firms will say, well, we have more women working there now, but it's the women partners, it's the women who are controlling the money and controlling what the firm is doing and investing in that I think is really important. And in terms of women technologists, you know, again, this goes to sort of STEM and STEAM education, you know, it goes to education. We just have to do a better job of being more inclusive in our educational environments to make it conducive for women to participate as well as excel. That then will extend to companies, and I know some tech companies in particular get a bad rap for having environments that are not particularly friendly for women and I would say for people, but just call me crazy.
Let's move into the second. And I was asking that first question because I remember at one of the events, the New York Tech Meetup, there was explicitly a moment of raising awareness about the gender gap within technology.
Yes, and I will just say that, you know, although, you know, tech in general is bad on that, and New York City isn't where we're supposed to be on that, but I will, as a New Yorker, I will just say that I think that, you know, I want to see New York City in particular do better. I think we do a little bit better than maybe some other Western coasts, in that we have people here in New York, and we have people from all different perspectives. We have, you know, people who actually don't, you know, aren't necessarily in the tech sector. So we have a lot more diversity in terms of color, in terms of, you know, economic scale, in terms of sectors and businesses. And that makes for a more conducive environment to growing companies, tech companies, but companies in general that I think are more important for the for the cities of the future. I think smart cities, the term, and you know how we look at cities of the future, a lot of people object to that term, smart cities. What does that mean? you know, in my mind, it really should be human cities, and we shouldn't have to say human cities. We should just be able to say cities, and of course, it's implicit that it means human. I think that so much of what we've heard here today is about how do we use technology in cities of the future, and how do we use it really for people. So there's a lot of conversations around interconnectedness and around networks, and in technology circles, a really hot topic these days is IoT, Internet of Things. And what does that really mean? And that's a very important conversation. IoT is an important conversation for cities of the future, right? For smart cities. Everything, it helps us connect better. We have to get data on everything, everyone. And that's great in many ways. That's happening, whether we want it or not. And there's I think we really have to think long and hard about that and what it means. It's great to get data. It's great to use data for people and for, say, you know, health and hospitals, and where literally you can save lives, to save, you know, traffic and our transportation systems, what we just heard. You know, we have to be connected to the internet. We have to be connected to each other. But we really better think long and hard about how we design and how our technologists design for cities of the future, and for using that data and that IoT information and our, you know, just, you know, technology companies, how are we designing, again, with people, with citizens, with women, or people who are not as at our forefront in our political conversations as they should be. And if we don't get pretty serious about democratizing our technology, then we're not going to be very serious, and we're going to be having some bad, well, I guess we've already had some bad shit go down.
Could you give us three measures of success?
Three measures of success. You know, I would say that for me personally, again, I think measures of success for the internet, for a technology company, are how does it help people, and how does it help people who can't afford to go to the institution that was shown by our previous speaker with the big T for tuition. You know, how does it really help lots of people? And how are we thinking about people who are not included in some other conversations? You know, I would say that so it sounds very easy to say design for people. It's pretty broad swath in many ways, but I think it's a very important swath, and I think it's a very important to really look at what does that mean. And somebody else, one of our other speakers, mentioned values. You know, what are our values? And when you, it's easy to start and use technology these days, right? And even to start companies in some ways, you know, there's the cloud. I mean, certainly from when I started out many years ago, it was more difficult to start tech. You needed more money, you needed more time, you needed lots of people, you needed certain types of education. You know, it's a little bit easier now, and that's great. But we better really do some work in and our technologists too, in what are the biases that we're bringing when we design. I'm not an architect at all, and I'm not an artist, as these wonderful people that you have here today. But I would think that, you know, architects in particular, you know, must think about that all the time. What are the biases in designing just a space? You know, who's it for? Is it for
It's nice because you have the index number 3 that in fact asks you about how does one distinguish between initiatives that make us more equal versus initiatives that set us apart? How architecture or art serves the elites or the tourist class or the or serves those higher ideas of all of us, or the disempowered ones? And how do you measure that with your work and others?
Yeah, and I would say that, you know, again, you know, IoT is the future, and what does that mean really? It's collecting data. And how are we using that data? And how are we collecting the data? Are we collecting it from everyone? You know, when you take a city like New York, as our previous speaker said, you know, what even is New York? It is, you know, I grew up in Manhattan, and I'm, you know, I'm very Manhattan-centric in a certain way. But, you know, there's a lot of boroughs around, and there's a lot of people in those boroughs. And so we have to get to those edges. And, you know, it just starts with something simple like just access to the internet. So, like, way uptown in Harlem, we're not doing our job in terms of access to high-speed internet. That's just one small, you know, and all cities have to deal with this. So there's access. Technology, we better democratize our access, because you know, I just heard a speaker on Friday from the Ford Foundation saying, you know, it's not just women's, as Hillary said, women's rights are human rights. It's also digital rights are human rights, and we better get real about that. And so I would say that, you know, our technologists and our tech designers should also think about, you know, are you inclusive of some of the edges, and are you inclusive of all people, and are you thinking about, you know, at least just to think about that when you're designing stuff?
There is one aspect that I think, for someone who is so knowledgeable of many of the ongoing things within the tech community, how does one start beyond the degree of coolness and innovation? How does one start to assess the agency and the politics behind a new app or a new project or a new product? And so this idea of like the FTI, the Freedom Technology Index, how much is a particular technology resistant to be co-opted or appropriated by the structures of government or the structures of like capital abuse?
Yeah, and that's really hard, right? I think we're at a very critical moment because on the one hand, like I said, we want to have an open internet, or some of us do. Some of the early people who designed the web really wanted that. My friend Douglas Rushkoff, I don't know how many of you know the book Throwing Rocks at the Google Bus. Does anybody know that book? Yeah. So, you know, Douglas talks about how, you know, these wonderful smart people design these things, you know, Google and Facebook and Apple and these incredibly new technologies and new ways to connect and get information. And it was really heady, exciting times. How did, you know, he sort of asked in that book, how did we then get to the place where we've got people throwing rocks at the Google bus? How did that happen? That's, you know, not here in New York City, but in San Francisco. You know, somehow these jobs that these companies got, and particularly for the technologists, became, you know, very high-paying jobs, and people started making lots of money, and the companies started making lots of money, and the venture capitalists who invested in the company started, you know, demanding more money, and then there was speed, and you got to make more, and you got to make it bigger and faster and harder and more and more and more. And then what about the people? You know, Douglas is who was saying, I'm on team human. You know, the people who were living in close to these companies who had to get to work are suddenly edging out a lot of the people who can't afford and don't have these big salaries and jobs at companies like that. And so you have some strife, and people are not happy. And that's, we really better look at that. We really better analyze that. We really better care and understand that, because that should, let's hope that's not just the beginning. you know, and then you have, where did we get to the place that we are now with this current administration? That's, you know, I don't know if I'm allowed to show a side here or whatever, but, you know, that's just so not okay. And technologies, it makes me sad if technology and media had a hand in that. So the open internet is great, and proposes a more democratic way for access and for people to say things and for stories to be heard and all that. But then it can also be a place where there's, you know, bad shit going down, bad actors doing bad stuff, and one of them happens to be our president, sadly. But you know, again, so I think the answer lies somewhere in paying attention and being woke, for one, but also working. You know, government is us. Government is people. We are government too, and let's bring our tech skills, or frankly whatever skills we have, to government to make it the place we want it to be, with the values we want to espouse. And I think it's a sort of a hybrid situation, a partnership, you know, whatever. But what can I say?
I think with that, we're going to leave it for the partnership of the following panel.
Thank you so much for having me today.
Thank you for having me. Let me, it's the clicker. It works. Okay, I want to... I love digital technology and smart cities, and I think it's good to say it because it's so easy to be critical. And we try to reframe with our office and a research group that we've been working with in Amsterdam some of the insights from the smart city and reframed it as a hackable city. And I'd like to give you one example of our sort of research project that we have been doing in our Amsterdam office and explain a bit this concept of the hackable city. This is a brownfield in Amsterdam just north of Central Station that was due for development in the mid noughts, and with the real estate crisis happening in 2008, for a while nothing really happened. And then that's not entirely true, but because while no development took place in Amsterdam in about 10 years, or maybe about 8 years between 2008 and 2016, some small things started happening in this brownfield. You see them here. Some apartment buildings on a small scale have been built. Some individual houses have been built. And it's very interesting to see these developments, because they were not driven by the traditional real estate industry. They were driven by normal people who sort of had jobs and found a way to get a mortgage and build an individual house, or built with groups of people apartments, buildings. They do this in Berlin a lot, they do this in Amsterdam, and we just heard this week that this particular project that we were involved with has been nominated for the prize of the best real estate developer in Amsterdam, and this is what the Amsterdam real estate developers look like. These are a bunch of teachers. There's one architect who works in my Dutch office. There's a guy who works in a lab somewhere. There's like normal people who grouped together and start building these buildings there. And for us, this is very interesting, because what we see here is a group of people who in some way hacked the real estate chain. And with a research project that we did with some Amsterdam universities, we looked a bit at how is this possible in this time. And we think that digital technology and some of the affordances of digital technology play a great role in that. We looked a bit at some of let's say apps or websites, or basically where communities organized themselves through digital technology. Peerby is one that people might know. I have to hang a painting once every 4 years.
Normally, I would buy a new drill every 4 years. Then to lose it, a peer buy allows me to find out which of my neighbors might have a drill that I can then use for maybe half an hour and pay him a number of euros. Farming the city is a site where people exchange knowledge about how to do urban farming. Verbeter de Buurt is a site where people, and you have those here as well, where people sort of talk about things that are going wrong and organize groups how to improve them. This, to me, is a smart and social city, and we looked at how these processes worked and how you could, in a way, develop a set of protocols of these processes. And that led to us to a definition, so in a way a sort of normative definition, where we say in a hackable city, digital technologies are employed to open up urban institutions and infrastructures to systemic change in the public interest. And to us, this was a sort of counterpoint to smart cities. And hacking is, to us, many people said it's not really a commercial word. You shouldn't use this for your branding. But it is an important word because it sort of foregrounds the role of new media. It brings out an ethic of collaboration, iterative design, learning by doing. And it allows us to explore the sort of hackability of system. But there's also a very much a sort of ethical or political agenda to this notion of hacking. And so what we try to do in based on this project in Amsterdam North, which I think by this moment, by almost every smart city index, will rank really very high, is to understand this development as a multi-level hackable system. And we use this as what you could call both an analytical and an operational model of what we see happening. In cities, a lot of people do stuff. They develop stuff, they build stuff, they take initiatives, and that's all great. Often they're able to do these things because now information is much more readily available. Much of these individuals start to often form collectives in order to exchange information, in order to exchange resources, and in order to work towards joint benefits. And this is all very well and good, but what is, I think, important for the idea of a hackable city is that you make another loop, which is how these, to understand how collectives can start changing the institutions that shape the city and its infrastructures by, on the one hand, providing signals and indicators such that the institutions might change and bring resources to the table or change the frameworks in which, for instance, development can take place. And the hackable idea is here on sort of multiple levels. And let me give you one example of how this is, let's say, operational in the case of Amsterdam with these self-builders. What you find is that everyone who builds a house for the first time, who is not an architect, runs into a lot of problems. It is great that people start sharing knowledge about this stuff, and they often use digital tools to do that. What we realize is that if you start to sort of harvest these different exchanges, both through physical interaction and through data analysis, you can start building, in a way, wikis or exchange tools for this type of information, which then helps promote this culture of self-building. If this culture has started to take a hold in a place where maybe it was only allowed during a prolonged real estate crisis, it is very important to sort of develop the data and the metrics which show why this stuff is great, why this stuff is more sustainable, why people are starting to be more intelligent about the way they use materials, they use energy systems, they develop their water systems, the way their houses are often much more flexible, much more diverse, and in general much more loved, and actually cost much less, or actually more of the cost is put into, let's say, stone. And with these metrics, you can then start to form new alliances, do serious gaming, etc., to start to really change the way in which the institutional actors deal with these things, because the utilities need to change, the banks need to change, the municipality needs to make different regulations, etc. So this is to us what perhaps a hackable city could look like and could then start to really organize systemic change in the way we make our cities. It helped us understand how this particular area is not just a sort of physical construct, but is as much a digital construct as it is a way in which an environment in which resources are exchanged, where material flows are running different, where the water and energy and systems are running very much different than they do now. There's many more layers at which this works. But going back to the houses, to the housing development, we showed how these this type of approaches created, in a way, more value for money. People invested more money into the house itself rather than into, let's say, the overhead for the real estate brokers, the project the real estate developers, and all these other Mr. 10% that are part of the real estate value chain. We see how, in a way, the community that is built there, because the people interact with each other, get to meet each other, work on these things together, creates a place where people like to live, and that in some way starts to create a sort of vibe in the neighborhood that people want to be part of. So it's we see how these technologies allow, for instance, the exchange of the collaborating on energy systems, etc., organized local exchange mechanisms that make it possible to make the housing much more sustainable and have a whole set of possibilities. We see that there's much more social involvement in these type of developments than you would normally have. People are building their own houses. They would meet at our office. This is our Dutch office. Every Wednesday to just sort of draw and sketch together and make plans together on doing these type of buildings. They start organizing collective spaces together. They start organizing outdoor spaces together. They sometimes even start to organize businesses together, all in a way through the affordances of the digital technologies that are normally associated with this wonderful thing that we call smart cities, once you start to think of them from a different perspective. So if I had to come up with a metric, I would say that much of the value that is now sort of created by smart cities ends up in Silicon Valley or in Wall Street, that is sort of Mr. 10 or I think 35% in Uber's case, who sort of bring all this value into the system of global capital. And I would propose a hackable city index, which would measure the ability to keep value and resources local or within the community. Thank you very much.
Hello, thank you so much for having me. My name is Dorit. I'm a PhD student here at the New School. I'm studying public and urban policy, and I was invited here to speak a bit about digital equity. I thought we were going to hear a bit more about the taxonomy. If anybody wants to shout out at me later, my email address will be in the last slide. I'm happy to unpack more of that later. But when I was asked to develop a digital equity index for measuring smart cities, this question came to mind. How smart can a city be when it's built on top of inequity? So the language here, right? A lot of it is evolving as fast as the technology that it refers to, digital equity versus digital inclusion. Let's start with digital equity. We've heard a lot from people actually today discussing access and tech literacy, and that's kind of the fundamental of what we're generally talking about when we talk about digital equity. The National Digital Inclusion Alliance, big shout, look them up, they're awesome. They offer some really helpful definitions. There's for digital equity, a condition in which all individuals and communities have the information technology capacity needed for full participation in our society, democracy, and economy. Okay, so to get to the digital equity as an index, as I'm proposing, we need to expand the term. We need to activate it so that it can address the systemic inequality, which to date has been a largely hidden foundation underlying smart cities. That's part of what I'm arguing here. So shout outs to anybody, again, who is discussing more radical language for this. I'd love to hear it. For the sake of this presentation, we're going to stick with digital inclusion, which deals with social justice and systemic inequality in the work that I'm dealing with. It actually has to do with data sovereignty, security from online surveillance for marginalized communities, and thinking of digital space as inexorably linked to issues of social justice. So the NDIA definition, which is a bit more refined, says that digital inclusion requires intentional strategies, what I'm thinking of as actions, and investments to reduce and eliminate historical, institutional, and structural barriers to access and use technology. So Angela Seifer, the director of the NDIA, she posits digital inclusion as a means to achieving digital equity, where digital equity is a constantly moving target that may never be achieved. And I really like that. So questions here. Is more technology the solution for digital equity? You know, what happens if we continue to put equitable access to technology ahead of digital inclusion? Well, equity before inclusion. What foundation are we actually building on? I think that's important to really consider, particularly in the American scope. I look forward, after hearing all the presentations today, actually, to taking some of these ideas more global. But here in the U.S., in the mid-90s, for example, there's some stats that I think are helpful to ground us, right? In the mid-90s, we had 518,000 African Americans with modem access that would give them access to the internet. And we know that the internet has a direct impact on increased wages, and that places where access to these tools is prohibitive, there's greater economic divergence and disparity, right? So here we have the mid-90s, 518,000 African Americans with modem access. At that same time, we had 10.1 million white Americans with that same modem access. So if we actually think about that in terms of the demographics of the time, that means that white Americans were nearly four times more likely to have internet access than black Americans in the mid-90s, and that's where we're starting from. So if we apply additional technology without tackling legacy issues like this of systemic injustice, it's like going the All Lives Matter route at a time when the Black Lives Matter movement needs to be heeded. And I think that this cartoon actually does a really good job of making this point. There are issues of inequity that are real fires in our midst, and expanding technology and efficiency-driven smart cities design seems to encourage us to look the other way. So what are smart cities really solving for? Are we solving just for efficiency, or are we solving for a legacy of systemic injustice? I think one of the ways that I like to spatialize this issue is actually to consider redlining. So we're going to do a quick kind of overview of redlining. Here we go. This is a map of Cleveland, Ohio. It's the residential security map. Wikipedia gives a definition of redlining as the practice of denying services either directly or through selectively raising prices to residents of certain areas based on racial or ethnic composition of those areas. So 1935, the Home Owners Loan Corporation, which was a New Deal era housing policy guaranteeing 30-year home loans to white folks, created these residential security maps. But this, although it's Cleveland, Ohio, is representative of maps that have exist from the time across the country. These maps served as a guide, actually, for insurance companies and banks to prohibit access to home ownership. And then that same redlining became electronic when phone lines and cable access were laid on those same guidelines for disparity. So communication infrastructure has been inequitably installed throughout history, and fiber optic cable, following along, the backbone of broadband delivery is being distributed following that same pattern. We're installing technology over inequity. So here we're looking at the same area, Cleveland, Ohio again, but with FCC data associated with AT&T's expanding high-speed internet laid on top of it. So this is actually from a study conducted by Connect Your Community and the NDIA. Highly recommend looking it up. It's a really interesting study. Their analysis strongly suggests that AT&T has systematically discriminated against lower-income Cleveland neighborhoods in its deployment of home internet over the past decade. Now, I know the map is a little bit hard to read here. Look it up on the website. It's really great. The point really is that the suburban areas are fully covered by AT&T's fastest available service, while most of the city, which is representative of minorities and low-income individuals, completely left out. So there's a startling correlation between areas where AT&T has not invested in faster service and areas of high poverty. And part of what grounds this actually in the smart city debate and the smart city dialogue that we're having today is the way that AT&T and their PR team responded to this study. So here's a quote, actually, from their response. "While we are investing in broadband, we're also investing in technologies that will mitigate some of these infrastructural limitations." The response is actually really long, and it boasts all the intricate types of technology that they're promising, but they don't address the fundamental issue, or what I define as the fundamental issue, that for whatever reason, AT&T systematically bypassed lower-income neighborhoods in its deployment of better service, period. While AT&T might be doing their best to promote equity by improving technology, they're not doing a good job of being inclusive from the outset. Expanding technology does not solve the problem if the new tech is built on the same inequitable foundations. And this systemic bypassing, it actually doesn't end with just tech redlining. The term is being adopted across other areas as well. Community colleges, which predominantly serve working class communities and communities of color, they actually have data, this shocked me, data policies in place that undermine students' progress and success. Students accessing information in their libraries are actually restricted in the data sets that they get, and they're restricted also to smaller journal sets. They're also more likely to be tracked in their usage and in their searches. Then we go the consumer route. We've got Pokemon Go, which I haven't played, but I hear people love. That's actually app redlining. I'm sure everybody's heard of that, right? All of these different types. Pokestops and Pokegym locations in the game were actually crowdsourced from Niantic, who already skewed for users who were English speakers, older males, a demographic who already have the leisure time, the hardware tools, and the money to buy data plans necessary to play. So the end result here is a very close mapping between Pokemon locations and wealthier, whiter neighborhoods. I read in an article, redlining via augmented reality. I thought that was pretty great. Once again, inequitable foundation tends to reproduce itself in any new application of technology. So this actually goes into the research that I'm doing and looking at storefront corridors and beginning to kind of map consumer behaviors and the way that we behave online in what we actually find in our storefront corridors and our streets. So that actually, the example here is very personal. I needed some toilet paper today, and I will tell you, I did not go to one of the 100 bodegas in my neighborhood. I pulled up my phone, and I bought it on Amazon along with some toothpaste. And consumer behavior like mine, which is contingent on digital access and privilege, it has an impact. It has an impact on my community. It has an impact on my ability to maintain my wealth and privilege. It all is correlated, and I look forward to doing further study to see what those exact correlations are. So the digital equity index, the digital inclusion index, would be inclusion from the outset. While equity continues to be a moving target, the way we integrate inclusion into smart city design will define how close we get to hitting it. So how smart can a city be? I would say that cities that design technology that seek to solve for inequitable foundations rather than perceived inefficiencies would be pretty smart to me. Using inclusion and equitable access as a foundational premise, though, it requires a unique paradigm shift, one that puts inclusion ahead of efficiency. That's a hard sell for entities that seek to modernize citizenry. Embracing a digital equity index can allow us to examine historical factors and previous eras of policy and infrastructure development and help us to define measures for inequities in those systems. Using this index, how would we measure how smart a city is? We'd measure a city's smartness based on how well it corrects for this and other inequities. Thank you very much.
Hello, so thank you all the speakers for the presentations, and if you wanna join us in the discussion. So there are very different presentations, but in a way it's possible to draw some connections. But I want to start with Mark, with your reading of the crowds image and a connection to core. So thinking about images and codes, and this idea of the image of the city, It seems that in core, it operates in two levels. On the one hand, there is this aesthetic image and a representation of the city through core, in which we see all these screens and that naturalize somehow the image. But on the other, we know that there are series of algorithms that are reading the city differently. So how do you see the interaction between these two systems, the one which we see as humans, and there is an image of the city that is recognizable, and there is a particular code and index, and the other that we might not see, but is operating as well. So is converging in the same image, or they are two different systems, and to one we even don't have access?
Farzan may want to answer this as well, but I'll give it a first stab, because, I mean, part of what we tried to come to terms with was what many people are thinking about is what the image of the smart city is. But with core, it gave us a very concrete example. And so I'd say it splinters in even more ways than we described here. So the first would be the image of the command and control center as a space of representation of the city. The second would be the hidden mechanisms behind that, the algorithms that make decisions based on the sensors that come back to the control center. But what we didn't talk about is how that data gets to the control center, and that's one of the things that fascinated us the most, which is that Rio offers such a weird contradiction of a city that doesn't seem to be the most hospitable to that fantasy of the smooth rationality of the smart city, because of all of its infrastructural problems, because of its financial inequities, etc. So the idea that the city would monitor itself and core would be the space of that monitoring failed drastically, as far as we can tell. The way most of the sensing happens is that citizens participate by using non-smart cell phones, making phone calls, delivering information about traffic jams and interruptions. And so the thing that we don't see is not just the algorithm, and it's not just the condensed image of the city as we see in those screens, but those acts of interpolation of notions of citizen participation. And secondly, and this is where it gets so fascinating in Rio, is that the core headquarters is open to citizens who are able to view the information on the screen and to view the operations of the algorithm. And so you can stand on the balcony and watch what's happening, and you can watch decisions happening in real time, or you can watch on the internet. And so instead of it being some kind of nefarious notion of governmental control, it's offered as just the opposite. It's offered as a space of press relations for the city, in which some notion, some shared fantasy of the smooth administration of the city is one that everyone participates in. So what you see there, in fact, is an effort to move the city towards some notion of unproblematic administration in which everyone participates. And so that's the other image of the city that we're trying to get at. And part of what we mean by computational governmentality is not just the use of data through algorithms and computation. It's that construction of the image of the city through the population's desire of a better managed city somehow constructed through that space.
Yeah, I wanted to also connect to that, so, well, maybe to Farzan as well, because you were presenting all these different disruptions. And if mostly all of them are connected to a very particular temporality that is quite short. So what you will imagine about the smart city or this core is that not only is able to respond in a very short time to these events and disruptions, but also maybe to predict them. But again, going back to the idea of what we are reading, in a sense, or a landslide, or a festival, and somehow are visible also for us. So obviously you need algorithms to activate other systems, but there is a very short temporality. Do you think there are other type of disruptions that you were not listing, but actually are more connected to maybe the idea of the smart city, that this other index or disruption that you listed are more connected to a more not even digital cities?
Is that working? Yeah. Maybe to take like a step back to answer that question. I think like in a conference about urban epistemologies, part of what we have to do is maybe as architects offer other sort of possibilities for what that future city looks like. And for us, why Rio is really interesting is because of what Mark's saying, that where that sort of smooth IBM logic kind of hits the sort of specificities of Rio, that as architects, we perhaps like from a global north perspective, traditionally looked at and been fascinated by its informal structures in some way, or looked at the sort of instability of that city as a model for some type of urban condition that isn't premised on a kind of a 1950s planning logic. And so for us with CORE and these kind of incidents that we identify, these interruptions, there was an attempt to think about how that city is both predicted through CORE and managed, but also how it starts, like what happens if when that feedback is kind of accelerated, and like what type of city does this kind of start to anticipate, but also to produce? And we don't really know what that city looks like, right? We have the wonderful graphics that we've seen many versions of, and we have the wonderful sort of PR campaigns, and we don't have a kind of cartography of it. We don't have a master plan of it. We don't have a kind of a concrete, to use the sort of parlance, like a vision of what that, you know, city is meant to look like once it's kind of come under the control of, thank you, I appreciate that. It's my pink, my lucky pink marker. And so part of what we're attempting to do as, I guess, architects, like looking at this condition, was to start to think about what this emerging kind of computational governmentality that meets urbanism looks like, but to perhaps by producing a cartography to ask, surely we can optimize for things outside of smooth, stable flow of traffic. And perhaps like to some of the things that you were saying, like can we start to, you know, using this kind of existing technologies and relationships and the hackable city, right? And like we have, like finally the computational city has arrived after many years, and the technology's there, the infrastructure set up, the relationships are there, the kind of funding structures are there. Surely as architects, maybe we can offer something there other than efficient use of energy, connectivity as a community, tool sharing, and kind of amenity elevated to the level of like smooth city administration. Maybe we could optimize for disruptions. Maybe we could optimize for, you know, other types of non-optimal operations.
Yeah, I see that there is some of you who were somehow even fetishizing the idea of the incident somehow. And there were others who were pleasing or embracing the idea of the smoothness. And in particular, well, you can see it very clearly with Ingrid and Jim, you know, this, how Ingrid, you were talking about the sim, and somehow Jim was totally talking about how to design an infrastructural system, a transportation system that will be seamless, no? That you can drive, or you can go through one place to the other in the city without even having to bother about the who was managing the trucks. So I would like to understand, maybe Ingrid, do you want to respond to what the plan that Jim presented?
I appreciated your like willful misreading of my slides. I'm often wary of the sort of like the portrait of like nostalgia for the 1970s that suggests a willful ignorance of like the discomforts of the past, right? And I think maybe the point I was trying to get at more in recognizing kind of like grime and seams and like in some ways just kind of like the legibility of a system is that like is a sense of kind of like that there are political decisions that go into making cities function, right? And like the very small pieces that kind of demonstrate how humans are part of that and how like they kind of require like attention and care. I guess it's maybe grime is not quite the one. It's maybe more kind of like the way that like, you know, you need good bacteria I am not sure entirely that was a good response or answer, but I think that in terms of how I was positioning this point, I think it was less of a sense of nostalgia for a time that I didn't experience so much as like a recognition that like any system that kind of gets to like large infrastructural systems will be misused. And I think that there's sort of an assumption in a lot of, you know, seamless master plans that misuse is kind of like something to be kind of like worked or like designed against or refused. And I think that that's sort of, that's like a losing game.
If we think about indexes, I could read from your presentation that there is the SIM index, so a city that how can you strike what type of information or value you can read from that index?
I mean, you could look at like things like the number of the New York City Department of Transportation publishes things about like street excavations at any given time, and like the timeliness of repairs, the number of things that are getting kind of like improved and upgraded at any given time, the kind of continued like, oh, like that pothole got fixed, those sorts of things. I think that those are kinds of like really obvious examples of kind of like celebrating sort of the like attention to the visible scene.
But do you think in a city in which it is more visible, these seams and patches, is connected to capital, is connected to the ability of the city to regenerate faster, or do you think it's connected to maybe to other type of indicators?
I mean, I guess the other thing, and I think you mentioned this in your email, just the ways in which like the city that you live in often has a sort of like smoothness that can be a little bit like uncanny or like irritating. And I think to me what I sometimes feel in those environments and in cities that sort of feel more like malls or airports than like actual like places humans operate is that there's a sense of also like a lack of responsibility or a lack of like sense that I have any responsibility to the city. Like it's like, someone else is kind of taking care of things. And I think that kind of like also kind of wilts away at someone's sense of kind of agency. And you also kind of start to wonder like, where did all of the dirt go? Like, I don't know. Often when I think about kind of the future of the built environment, I go to sci-fi. And I was either going to talk about Demolition Man or Her in this panel. I'm going to go with Her for now. But when watching that film, I don't know if people saw it, I was very angry because I kept just going, where are all the homeless people in Los Angeles? Right? That movie is like painfully clean. And I think about that as like that movie is also like painfully politically neutered. And there's something like the subtext within that is that like the smart city is for like all the other kind of aspects of like everyday life in the world become someone else's problem.
Jim, do you want to respond? Maybe one of the questions I have is, you know, on the one hand, you are proposing to expand what it is the core of New York. So in a way, you decentralize the center, but you use it and unifying infrastructure in order to create that. So I was interested in this tension. And on the one hand, the idea of like creating a city that is decentralized somehow, but in order to get that, you use very central somehow infrastructure. And the other will be, what is in your case the role of technology in that model?
I have my own. I think I may not have been that clear. I didn't mean to misread what you were saying about grime. I did very much appreciate your point. The idea that you don't design something, let's say an architect designing a building, just so that they can photograph it, move on, and let the client deal with the rest. The idea that buildings should be kickable, that you see their entire lifestyle, not just something I was raised on and very much simpatico to, and very much embrace that idea. And I wasn't trying to just kind of make a wordplay with it, although I did, first thing that hit my head was crime and then grime and all that. But I want to also just say in response to what you're saying is I'm very simpatico to the question, the premise of this panel, because in thinking about this, the most famous index that we have is the Dow Jones Industrial Average. So that's a certain type of values that are associated with this. So how do you create other indices that measure these things that I was talking about in my talk, the social versus the economic and such, and how can we do that? And I thought, Ingrid, you were remarkably successful in that. To get to the point of your question, I could spend 2 hours talking about the technology of what we're proposing. It's not necessarily a question of decentral versus central. It was really just a question of what we're doing with relation to solving the problem of, in other words, it's sort of a very academic type of conference where you're defining the problem, but we're kind of bring something differently, which is to solve the problem explicitly with an explicit solution. And that explicit solution is basically to say that the problem is defined for us as high real estate based on over-concentration of the core, and therefore the solution is to expand the transportation system in the sort of car optional area, and that's a transportation operating systems is what Ford is talking about, this idea that your train is synced with your self-driving car, or let's say Uber pool for today and that kind of thing, to solve problems that previously had been unsolvable. The power broker, Robert Caro, talked about the problem of how Long Island was developed around the automobile. Well, the Uber pool and these carpooling solves the last mile that makes it possible to use public transport and completely change the sociology of the city in that relationship and breaking down that suburban-urban divide and the values of sort of white flight post-war suburbia versus urban blight. And my point wasn't nostalgia necessarily for 1970s New York, although it is a time that has value, I think, versus a time to be degraded, which is something there's, but to move on from both of these kind of imbalances to create a more balanced environment. And so this rejection of the antiseptic kind of that you're talking about is something, again, I'm simpatico to. And being able to do that is to look at places like Paterson, New Jersey, frankly, which I imagine not very many of us spend a lot of time in, but is very rail connected and could offer opportunity to be what Brooklyn used to be.
So in a way, this idea that strikes me still is when we were thinking at the beginning about the smart cities that will bring logics that will be completely maybe different of what we will generally read as designers, no? So we will imagine that maybe a city wouldn't need a very unified infrastructure system, because through technology we will be able to be efficient by using different parts of the networks differently without the need that this is visible, no? That this is readable and having a main line. So I find it interesting, but I think it's a question between that also was you were bringing Dorit and Matthias in connection to the idea of locality or the idea of the community, or the idea of how actually the geographical location plays a role. That again, you will imagine that with the digital, there will be the idea of community that will go beyond the proximity, the idea of the local. So I was very interested in your last slide when you were saying most of the profits of the digital technologies are going to Silicon Valley, so we have to appropriate that. Like, it has to be the value that is created in local communities has to stay, and I think it's to the point. But my question will be then how you scale what is the scalability of that model? Because if we think about communities creating value, then how do you do, how you imagine redistribution again? How do you imagine that will be a system that could be scalable and going beyond the local and the community as geographically connected?
I think in that Dorit made a very valid contribution, but basically the issue with what I find interesting about smart cities is that it's a set of tools. What I find dangerous about smart cities is that the way in which we sort of negotiate the tools and look at their efficiency is mostly through thinking in terms of money. That's the way how we, in a way, define often value as a sort of there might be other values embedded in it, but the easier way to talk about them is through money. And through that, it becomes very easy, I think, for certain actors or companies or whatever to play let's say, a significant role in capturing that that money. I think that if you look at it as a set of tools, groups, communities can form and utilize tools if they have access to these tools. So I think the question of, let's say, inclusion in that and equity in that is really important. And I think one of the reasons that for us the Hackable City is a sort of interesting model is that we see something happening in one neighborhood, and the question becomes, how do you scale that up and change with that the culture of with which we build cities in Amsterdam? And that is always then, in, if you want to have a role in that, you need to start changing both the institutions, as well as make sure that individuals and especially vulnerable, disadvantaged communities, because now these the people who have been sort of starting these experiments are mostly well-educated, have access to these tools, know how to use them, so you really make sure that you continue this, let's say, interplay between big stuff, institutions, big money, what can happen locally, and because it's often also at the local level that the innovation really takes place and that values get tweaked, changed, updated, because one of the things is, of course, that where the value in, I think, in Rio is the value of security more than anything else. But I think the conversation about what is the value that we want out of this stuff is a very political one, and I don't think that security is the most interesting answer.
And Dorit, I think we have been going through this index, maybe the SIM index or the seamless index, the accessibility index, and in your case you introduced this idea. I was imagining when you proposed a topic like digital equity, and I was imagining the idea that digital technologies and this index will not be connected to a particular territory, and you again and again were showing how particular areas in our city in which particular communities are living are target, and they are not. It's not a question of inclusion, it's a question of just rights.
A couple things. Such great thought company, first of all, I wanted to say. Also, from the previous panel through our panel, I think there's something so interesting in the way that we all respond to the cleanup of cities. And I wonder if part of the reason that we respond to it so emotionally in any direction is because when we clean over a city, when we remove that grime, we remove access to the visible history that's there, and it kind of gives us an opportunity to think around issues of injustice that we all feel, that we all know is present. And when we get into any kind of concrete dialogue about these issues, it tends to come back to this, and yet the world and the smart cities and the clean cities that we see kind of evolving around us erase that history. They erase that from being a part of our tangible presence. And I think that, yeah, that's where the nostalgia gets wonky, right? It's like we don't want to be nostalgic, and yet we understand the value that existed in 1970s New York, for instance, when artists could be here. And people spoke a lot today, actually, about the value of bringing artists into cities and how that type of thinking, I guess we could argue, maybe it is inherently more equitable in some way, just because it's more holistic, it's more in touch with the heart. I don't know. But really, these issues of inclusion, these issues, whatever the new language will be, there will surely be new language on the heels of today even. But whatever that is, to let it be at the outset of the way that we design anything, right? To not let it be the afterthought, to not let it be the thing that we discuss at the cocktail party later, or that somebody gets brought in to critique us for having ignored, but that we as designers, as thinkers in the space, actually let that drive the way that we design and the way that we think.
I'm going to open the questions to the audience, because I imagine that you have some questions.
Just thank you. thank you to all the panelists. Just to follow up with, this is a weird echo, Dorit and the larger topic of redlining. If we understand the COR as trying to promote some sort of participatory urbanism where the city sees its own effects, what would that be in Cleveland with AT&T or the city? Is there something there that helps solve it, or is that adding to the problem?
Yeah, no, I mean, participation is key, but that actually speaks to what Jim was saying a little bit, right? I mean, even once we have the access, how do we actually learn to integrate that access into our lives? When you go into a community meeting in Brooklyn, these places that we care so deeply about and these issues that we care so deeply about, they're still self-selecting for certain segments of society, certain types of individuals that maybe get a little louder. You know, how do we actually make that participatory? But I guess part of what I'm saying is that as we design technology, as we begin to think forward into what technology can be in a city, how do we allow that to solve for some of those issues? And I am not a technologist. I can't solve that today, but I would love to think with people that want to. So I guess that's part of what I might propose. But participation is really hard. Anybody that's ever tried to get a group of diverse stakeholders into a room to deal with a social issue knows that that takes real facilitation skills, that takes a level of training that we kind of ignore when we talk about technology, when we talk about just advancing tech on its own. So maybe it is about being, I don't know, speaking to different groups and making sure we have different types of design minds at the table. I don't know.
Do any of you want to add something, or?
One thing missing from all this talk about smart cities is the fact that cities are physical. For example, New York has a lot of water, making the plan that you discussed of, say, Berlin or London very difficult because you have to cross these large water channels. And you did not include anything about water transport as maybe a way of trying to accelerate or increase the amount of movement around, say, New Jersey to New York and so on. But I think also the same thing with Rio. Rio has mountains, which causing land slides. So it's a physical problem, same with San Francisco. So I think that we need to have more attention to the physical realities of each area. As a comment, and while inviting,
there are a lot of people that lost their lives building the Hudson River tunnels, the East River tunnels. They're presently 12 tracks between Queens and Manhattan. One of the great things about the unification of New York was that technology of the Brooklyn Bridge and all these things actually unified us. And so it's true, you're right. The regions that we have of our commuter rail systems are driven by rivers and geography. But in about 1900, we gained the technology to overcome that. And yet we're bound by that because of anachronistic borders and political and the fact that there was a decline in mid-20th century. And now there's a decline in sort of rethinking or independent thinking to look in this broader way that was there in the turn of the century with the unification and in 1931 with the first regional plan. So I don't think that's valid anymore in terms of the geographical barriers you're describing. However, that is a palimpsest that still exists in the mental barriers.
I just wanted to follow up on Max's question about participation and prediction and anticipation, because at least, you know, people here have a far deeper understanding of the complex history of American urbanism and its relationship to planning policies and its effects and what that means in terms of constituting neighborhoods and collectives and group formations. But what we discovered in Rio was that participation, it's not a term I'd want to deify or valorize unproblematically, because there's the form of participation which we identified at core, the kind of willing participation in the image of the well-managed city. And so one has to wonder about those effects. Part of what we're asking is, what is that mechanism of participation, which seems much different than the participation of protest, which happens quite often in the city. And so how do you start to dismantle those two modes of participation, what that means, versus the type of participation that we're all subject to, which is that we participate through feeding these systems and smart cities our data. And there's no way that we have much control over those mechanisms of participation. So I think that the smart city debate is a way for us to calibrate different notions of participation and to calibrate the political potentials of those forms of participation, which is why some notion of the hackable city seems very nice, that we can deturn the way in which we interact with those systems of technology as offering alternative notions of participation that aren't those that are fed to us automatically, let's say.
Hello, I think you just made a really good point about participation, because I can't help but think of user-created content. And I guess my question for you guys is about user-created content and the smart city in terms of how applications essentially you feed, right? So even though a community meeting might seem totally disconnected, it's not digital, it might not be recorded, might be recorded, but totally disconnected from most of the residents of a neighborhood and definitely disconnected from developers as well as industry factors. Probably there's a lot of people in that neighborhood who every day are uploading to Instagram and to Facebook and to YouTube. And I wonder if you guys can just speak a little bit about how participating actively in the smart, in our kind of like digital sphere of whether it's smart or not, it's debatable, but participating by uploading one's own information constantly into the system makes you maybe more akin to that system, or even potentially a kind of tool in the capitalist exploitation of the existing city.
I'm not going to answer all of that, but I might just like talk about user-generated content versus expert-generated content. And I think like the harkening back to the 70s, or when artists could afford to live in New York, is to say that outside of the information city or the economic city or the sustainable city or the knowledge city or the resilient city or the adaptive city or now the smart city, perhaps there was a time when the city was driven by things outside of economic and political imperative kind of going hand in hand. And if we understand the smart city is the latest upgrade to the information city, which is to say it follows whatever the current sort of economic and political sort of agenda is, and it's redefined with this new language. Maybe the 1970s was a moment when something outside of that was part of the city, right? And some sort of cultural production or some sort of imagination. And so I think that's what I want to offer today a little bit, to say that yes, utterly user-generated and participation is incredibly important. But a little bit of kind of imagination from a cultural practitioner is maybe okay as well. And so I don't want to like give you any, I don't want to produce anything that can happen space view. I want to kind of give you some small kind of hints about potentially exciting things that could happen. And so I think that can still fall under the rubrics of optimization. I think we just have to, and I think that can still fall within the structures of the sort of technologies and sort of relationships we have with our community and the sort of products that we have. I think it's just a question of imagination, like what do we want to do with that? And so opening that up to users is utterly kind of important, but also adding some version of the future information city that isn't the sort of Venn diagram of sustainability, security, and kind of, I don't know, what is it now, comfort or something. And so that would be, to that I would add architectural effect, or I don't know, I would add the city to that. And so that's something that participation defines.
I think one of the things that we are discovering while we're doing the Hackable City project is that we are starting first in Amsterdam, and many of the things that we thought we would do digitally, we discovered that we could do much easier in an analog way, because although they were originally inspired, so we sort of made the app analog, and then we did a project in Shenzhen, and then we discovered that that was on a scale that we couldn't do that anymore, but that it would be great to indeed sort of harvest some of the data of this on the social networks to come to a different understanding than you have as a sort of official understanding. But I think, like, if we keep this stuff close to us, if we keep it small, and we make sure that there's a sort of human component to all this stuff, we can influence it, and we can think about the tools with which we do think. I think the big danger is, of course, there's a whole set of almost totalitarian technologies that are starting to happen, but I think there's a political imperative to keep the things close to you and use these technologies. You can give people sensors. You can have, like, even, I think, you have the running technology which you can hack to discover how people use a city. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that is not so big that you can use locally, that you can sort of have a analog version of, or a minimum viable product that can already affect great change.
If there's time, this one, like, slightly, I don't know if maybe I thought this was kind of an optimistic antidote. I'm not sure. Earlier, at the end of the week, I was at this big event organized by the Knout Foundation, kind of kicking off a big, like, Internet of Things grant making series they're doing, and they had a panel of people who are like city planners and city managers and people who deal with tech, talking about implementing Internet of Things solutions in their cities. And first of all, like, most of the problems they were, like, dealing with were, like, not at the level of kind of grandeur, I think, of a lot of the things being described here. Was a lot of, like, you know, thinking about the sewage system and, like, taking care of it better. And I was like, yes, this is my jam. And a lot of talk of, like, right of way and, like, leveraging, like, pre-existing fiber routes. It's like a lot more of kind of a logistical problem. But also, like, most of the people on that panel recognized that they were being sold a lot of snake oil, and they recognized that they were being taken advantage of by a lot of vendors, right? Like, that, great, we'll give you the right of way, we'll let you kind of, like, put in all these cool sensors, and you're just going to keep all that data, and you're only going to let us have some, like, kind of crappy API that lets us see the end product. Like, there's, you know, I mean, to be fair, like, I don't know if, like, people, you know, people from, like, the city planning offices of, like, San Jose, California, and Akron, Ohio are, like, a broad representative sample. But I guess there's something about knowing that kind of when you get to the, like, implementation level, that we're at a point in the kind of, like, smart city hype cycle where people who actually have to implement this shit recognize that they're getting sold a lot of BS is, like, kind of encouraging.
So we are going to, thank you so much for all your responses. We are going to finish here, but two things. One, we are going to have a 10-minute break, so 35, we come back. And second, I will ask you very briefly to rename again what is your index. So maybe it's different from the one you brought, and you, during this conversation, have come up with another one. So very briefly, just, you don't have to explain it, just name it.
I don't know, we had three, so we'll stick with the interruption index then.
I think the social versus the economic.
I'll take the other one, urban index.
Digital inclusion index for today.
I guess I'll just stick with seams.
Hackability.